This is obviously a charity and event that celebrates the power of music. I'm wondering if you can articulate what that unique magic, that power of music is in your life and our life.
I'm living proof that this music is the most evocative and transformative language on our planet. You know, I mean, here I am like a kid that grew up next to a swamp in New Jersey, and my music has gotten around the world, the stuff that I wrote in my bedroom. You know, and it's made a lot of people happy, and it's all about relating to people. And I think, like Peter Gabriel, I am a super fan, by the way. I climbed out my mother's window many times to get on a train to stand in the snow to get tickets at Madison Square Garden many times, you know. So he's what can you say? He's just a very unique artist, and come on, like Biko, Mercy Street, Family Snapshot. I don't know. I can go on and on and on and on. So I'm a huge fan. I'm still a fan.
And of all the great species of music, can you talk about the true essence, the spirit of rock?
Let's see. Well, it's vast. There's many different shades of it, obviously, and different compartmentalization of the whole thing. You know, it goes between blues, R&B. It's all revolving around good songs, though. That's really important. If you got a good song, you could be the best musician in the world. And if you don't have a good song to play, there's something that people are going to relate to. Music is an agent of healing, and that's what Nordoff Robbins is really about. You know, I mean, it's the most transformative and evocative language ever. I mean, you know, because it doesn't matter. I remember when, you know, in the early 80s when I started to travel the world, it was amazing that people that didn't even speak the language, they got the music. And it touched them somewhere. And that's what we do it for. It's the communication and the relatability of what it is. Peter's like a reporter. He brings, like, I would have never knew who Biko was if I didn't listen to that. I didn't know he was Mandela's predecessor. So, you know what I mean? Songs like that. So, I mean, like I said, I'm a super fan. Super geek for Peter.
Chris, of all of the amazing tracks you've been involved with and responsible for, why do you think Living on a Prayer is one of those songs that seems to connect universally and timelessly with so many people?
Because we've all been through that exact situation. I mean, my uncle got laid off from the docks. I just changed his name to protect the innocent. But, you know, it was a story about everybody. And I think that's the secret. I mean, I think that in the human condition, I think we all have more in common than not. Especially when you travel the world and you actually witness that, you know. And when people grab onto a song like that, or a song like It's My Life, which has actually surpassed that in whatever streaming now or something like that. It's over a billion streams or something like that, which is extremely flattering. You know, it's like, hey, something that came out of, you know, sitting around in your bedroom thinking about an idea and proclaiming that this is my life and this is what I hope to do with it and something like that. I mean, I think everybody's been in that position too, where you have to just like make a decision on who you are or who you want to be or who you dream to be, you know. And I've been lucky enough to actually have some of those dreams come true for me, so yeah.
What's next for you as well?
Continuation, obviously. You know, I love to work with, I play with everybody, for God's sake, you know what I mean? I'd love to work with other artists, but yeah, I have a new record that's ready to go, and I've been kind of holding it through the pandemic. And I say in the fall we're going to put it out.
How did you find the pandemic? Was it difficult not playing music or not being around people to play music?
You know, it was interesting for me because, like, it was probably one of the first times that I had a chance I forcibly slowed down. You know what I mean? So what that did for me was I just really practiced a lot. I wrote every day and wrote songs and just kind of, you know, sharpened the pencil and played a lot of piano too. And so it was actually a decent time for me, because it slowed me down on purpose.
Your new music, what can fans expect from that? Is it a continuation of a sound or a brand new sound?
I'm very proud of it. I've been, I don't write bad songs anymore. It just doesn't happen. So, and the people I work with would go, hey, that's bollocks, So it's like, but it's not hard for me. So, I'm just lucky that way. And plus, I just write all the time. So it's like a daily exercise for me. It's something that I try to come up with something every day, really. Oh, absolutely. It's like having a journal. It's like keeping a journal of your thoughts, keeping a journal of what's going on in your life, how you're feeling, and being around as much as I've been. Oh, my God.
Have a final word for the fans who have and continue to support you on that journey.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Get ready. So there's some good stuff coming. This is I'm sorry it's been so long, but the pandemic kind of held things up. But get ready. It's going to be a lot of fun. And it's coming soon.